spreading right there, including the lights were too bright, there were too many dirty dishes, and referring to his mother, you were in the room while I was in the kitchen. I am unable to distinguish between my problems, he wrote, because I have too many. At another point, he writes in what appears to be an online communication with a fellow gamer. I incessantly have nothing other than scorn for humanity. I have been desperate to feel anything positive for someone for my entire life. And recovered from his computer was a spreadsheet that Lanza put together for over 4 years, from 2006 through 2010, detailing mass killings all the way back to 1786. According to The Current, there was great detailing of these mass murders by Lanza, and the killings were arranged by how many people were murdered.
Oh, my God.
Allison.
Jean, oh, my God. I mean, to know that there were all of these red flags, it's just all so sickening. And, of course, heartbreaking to know that he was, in his own weird way, attempting to reach out to people, and how it could all have been missed or not attended to.
And it talks about his mother responding to the professional's report, saying, oh, it was just he was nervous being with the psychiatrist assessing him, and that was just that. And we'll have a plan for him to get into regular school later on in the college years.
Oh, my gosh. Just when you think it can't get more horrible, that story. Jean, thank you very much for the reporting.
I really hate to think about the families of the victims reading that news this morning. All right, a source tells CNN the president sees impeachment as a real possibility, even as Republicans in the Senate shrugging all of the revelations off. Big developments coming up next.
The typical
they're not acting in the best interest of the country.
Nobody wants this job. There's only one person who controls what happens in that White House.
The president needs somebody that is not going to alter their behavior when he enters the room.
Certainly, I'm favorably inclined to have a discussion with the president.
This is New Day with Allison Camerota and John Berman.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to your New Day. This will be quite a week for the White House. Today begins days of legal proceedings that could lead to more revelations in the Russia investigation. A source tells CNN that President Trump now thinks it is a real possibility that he could be impeached when Democrats take over the House. So that's a political issue. Legally, experts say the president could face indictment if he were out of office. It's complicated. Here's what we now know. 16 Trump associates had contacts with Russians during the campaign of the transition. Yesterday, we thought it was 14. Today, it is 16 on your screen. And the possibility that the Mueller probe could even expose more. So key Republicans, though, say they do not care. Senator Orrin Hatch went so far as to say, quote, okay, but I don't care. All I can say is he's doing a good job as president, end quote. The same cannot be said for 44 former senators. In a Washington Post op-ed, they warn that we are entering, quote, a dangerous period, and they urge current senators to put country ahead of partisanship. We'll speak to one of them.
So meanwhile, is a new concern for some powerful Americans and political groups, including the NRA. A source tells CNN that accused Russian spy Maria Butina is now working with federal prosecutors after agreeing to a plea deal. Butina is said to have cozied up to powerful figures to push Russian interests, even asking then-candidate Trump a question at a campaign event in 2015. Her appearance in court tomorrow is one of several events this week that could shed more light on the Russia investigation. Here's just a look at some of them. Today, former National Security Advisor Michael Flynn will ask a judge for no jail time in a sentencing memo. There's a hearing in Paul Manafort's federal case as prosecutors explain the lies they say he told that torpedoed his plea deal. Then tomorrow, Michael Cohen will learn his sentence for his campaign finance and business crimes in New York. You know, the one where he says the president ordered him to pay off a porn star to keep their alleged affair secret. And new this morning, a CNN poll shows that 50% of Americans think the Mueller investigation is likely to implicate the president in wrongdoing. Overall, the president's approval rating now stands at 39%. Joining us now, Jeffrey Toobin, Phil Mudd, Jackie Kucinich. Phil, I want to start with you. Actually, that's a head fake. Jeffrey,
wow.
I want to start with you, if I can, right there. That wasn't even intentional, though it had the effect I was going for. Look, even with this calendar of events, you see one hearing after another, one memo after another, even with these 16 Russians known to have made an outreach, or 16 people in the Trump orbit known to have been contacted by the Russians in the campaign, Senate Republicans have been asked, What do you make of all this? What do you make of the fact that President Trump might very well be indicted were he not in office? And their collective response, at least as of today, seems to be a shrug, or even more than that, I simply don't care. Allison Redwood, Orrin Hatch said, I want to play you a little more of what he said.
I don't think he was involved in crimes, but even then, you know, you can make anything a crime under the current laws. If you want to, you can blow it way out of proportion. You can do a lot of things.
You can blow it way out of proportion. He's talking specifically about the campaign finance thing, but the bigger picture here is that they're just not budging, Jeffrey.
Yeah, that's true. And I think, you know, the Republican Party as a group, and certainly it's true for members of the Senate, have said, made a collective decision that we're not going to change our minds about anything until all of these developments are wrapped up, until there's a Mueller report, and then we have to decide whether to throw Donald Trump over the side. I think that is very unlikely. The Republican Party, as John Boehner said not long ago, is the Trump Party today, and they are going down with the ship, if the ship is going down. I think if you look at Donald Trump's popularity within the Republican Party, within the voters, it's still very high, and the Republican politicians are following along.
So, Phil, more evidence, of course, will come out. We know from the sentencing memo with Cohen that Mueller believes and states affirmatively that Cohen was directed by individual one, who we know to be Donald Trump, to commit the campaign finance law. So we've heard from our experts, I believe you, that he would never do that with a single source. It's not just Michael Cohen's word, that he's corroborated it somehow. So the political winds may shift when other hard evidence is at some point revealed.
I think that's correct, and that's one reason if I were advising the Democrats, which would never happen in this planet, I would tell them, slow your roll. Any American today, and you look at what Republicans have said over the past 24 hours, is going to see this through a Democrat or Republican lens. The Mueller investigation over the next few months is going to turn up more information. We don't know, for example, about the extent of Roger Stone's interactions, both with the president and with Russians. We've only got a window onto that. I'm going to tell you that Mueller's going to give us an indication not only of what happened in terms of interactions with the Russians that give us a more complete picture, but it's going to give either ammunition to the Democrats or ammunition to the Republicans. So I think the picture will get a lot clearer. We still don't know a lot, but the people we haven't heard about, Stone, Jared Kushner, Don Jr., those are the people who we're going to learn about from Mueller, and we're going to learn whether or not there's enough ammunition here to go forward in the Congress. I don't think there is yet.
So, Jackie, what's interesting about what Phil is saying is this headline. You know, Jim Acosta is reporting that the president is worried now that he will be impeached, that he might be impeached by a Democratic House. The interesting thing is we actually heard the president say that or speculate about that on the campaign trail before the midterm election. It seems to me that he may be saying that because he's trying to rally
his base. Yeah, I don't know that he's worried. I mean, I think that seeing it as a real possibility is different than being worried. That sometimes works well for presidents, as we know from Bill Clinton.
Jackie, how do you see it?
Well, right. And so I think what the president's calculation is this could be good for him going into an election. It looks like the Democrats are attacking him. Look, he's done a really good job of tearing down Mueller and the Mueller report. Look at his approval ratings. Look at the report's approval ratings, particularly among Republicans, which is why I think you see these Republican senators standing firm with the president. Unless it starts affecting their own political fortunes or the political fortunes of the Senate, I think you're going to see them continue to hold firm and use the idea of impeachment to rally the Republican base and to make sure that they stand firm with the president.
You know, I just if I can respond to something Brother Mudd said, slowing the roll is a great idea for everyone involved here. You know, the Democrats are not stupid. They are not pushing impeachment while it is impossible to get 67 votes in the Senate. They are just never going to do that. They saw what happened in 1998 when Republicans pushed impeachment with no prospect of success in the Senate. We need to find out what the underlying facts are. You know, these court cases are coming out. Journalists are doing their work. All of that is a good process. But, a debate about impeachment at this point is premature on both sides.
But I do think that Democrats are going to, particularly in the House, are going to be fighting with their progressive base who do want to see an impeachment. And that's going to be up to what we think is Nancy Pelosi to keep that part of her caucus in check.
Right,
but there is no constituency in the core of the Democratic Party in Congress.
I don't disagree with you,
Jeffrey.
I'm just saying that this is going to be a pressure that they're going to feel.
I don't think that pressure is very strong. The people know that impeachment is going nowhere at the moment. I mean, in the Senate, and it's just not worth it.
Yeah, I mean, that's why I find Orrin Hatch's remarks so helpful, because at some point voters are going to have enough information and they're just going to have to make their own decisions. And if they're okay with Michael Cohen going to prison for a crime that he says was directed by his boss, everybody's going to make their own decisions in the ballot box. I mean, that's what I think. And Orrin Hatch is, and other Republicans are on the record as saying they don't care now about those things. They really cared in 1999, and now they don't care. Well, and I think that that's just a good bit of information for people.
Let's just read what Orrin Hatch said in 1999 as a button on this discussion, and then we'll move on. What Orrin Hatch said in 1999 was, committing crimes of moral turpitude such as perjury and obstruction of justice go to the heart of qualification for public office. These offenses were committed by the chief executive of our country, the individual who swore to faithfully execute the laws of the United States. 1999 Orrin Hatch versus the 2018 Orrin Hatch, who said, I don't care. Full stop. I want to talk about Maria Butina, if I can, please, who is going to enter a plea deal, apparently plead guilty to various crimes. And Phil Mott, I want to play for you a moment, which Allison so rightly said, appears in a whole different light now that we're getting this guilty plea. This was Maria Butina asking then-candidate Donald Trump a question about Russia on the campaign trail. Watch.
Do you want to continue the politics of sanctions that are damaging of both economy, or you have any other ideas?
I believe I would get along very nicely with Putin, okay? And I mean where we have the strength. I don't think you'd need the sanctions. I think that we would get along very, very well. I really believe that.
So that was 2015. Now you have someone who will plead guilty this week, Phil, to not registering as a foreign agent. She's not pleading guilty to being a spy, but not registering as a foreign agent, asking a question at a campaign rally to a president who is the focus, or at least a subject, in an investigation.
Look, now through the lens of everything that we now know with all the connections, it's hard to see these things as a coinkydink.
Yeah, but hold on a second here. I don't think you'll see a bunch of interaction between her and the Mueller investigation. There is one huge picture here that I want to paint. Forget about that it's 2015 and forget about whatever question she asked. Think about this. Everything that's happening around that question. I want to know if she's fully cooperating, who she spoke with beforehand, who she spoke with after, how they communicated, whether she got paid, how she got paid. In my business, the spy business, we call that tradecraft. I want to understand that tradecraft and how the Russians were interacting with this agent to see if I can identify similar tradecraft in other cases that might apply to the Mueller investigation. My bottom line, I don't care what she asks. I want to know what happened before and after to understand her pattern of activity with the Russian intelligence service here in the United States.
Well, I care what she asks. I mean, I would like to know about Donald Trump's answer, because remember, after Michael Cohen's guilty plea, we know that at the moment he was answering that question about how he wanted to be nice to Vladimir Putin, he was negotiating with the Russian government to try to make hundreds of millions of dollars from Moscow real estate, which is controlled by Vladimir Putin. So, I mean, the stories come together, and I think that question and answer, and why did he call on her out of all the journalists, what was the background there? That is part of the story that I would certainly like to know the answer to.
I agree, Jeffrey. I agree. I mean, again, maybe everything is just a wild coincidence, but was she a plant? Did he know that she was in the audience? Did he know she was going to ask a question about Russia? Was that a good opportunity for him to talk about how he wanted to be closer to Vladimir Putin while he was negotiating for the Moscow Trump Tower? I mean, there are some untied threads here, Jackie, that, again, with this week, with all of these different sentencing memos and plea deals, we might learn more about.
Right. I mean, with all of these plea deals, it feels like we are getting more pieces of the puzzle, but we don't have the clear picture. But all of those questions that you just asked, they merit answers for sure. Also, her ties to the National Rifle Association is something else that deserves There are a lot of questions that are unanswered there as well. And they also have a lot of influence with politicians across the board.
Yeah.
Jackie, can I just ask you, because you are in Washington and we were talking about Orrin Hatch before, in light of all this and the calendar that we've seen for this week, just one event after another in the Mueller probe, and these are just the ones we know. Look, we don't know if there's something else coming out in the next 2 weeks. Roger Stone, Jerome Corsi still hanging out there. How do Republicans really feel about all this? Is this a time when they're skipping in the hallways and they're, you know, singing songs, I'm psyched to be here on the job?
Well, in terms of the president, there are two main answers that you get. You get no collusion and you get look over there. I haven't read this yet. And so you hear a lot of I don't want to talk about this. There is a little bit of a feeling of slogging till the end for Republicans because they want to talk about pretty much anything else than what's going on with the White House and Russia.
And then Chuck Schumer and Nancy Pelosi will be meeting with the president today. That will be all sorts of new fodder.
Not to mention an impending government shutdown.
Yes. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Thank you all. Great conversation.
So you just mentioned it. This budget battle on Capitol Hill is heating up. The big debate centers around border wall funding. What will Nancy Pelosi and Chuck Schumer offer the president today? That's something we're going to keep our eye on. Shoulders at the allegations laid out by prosecutors that directly implicate President Trump, possibly in two crimes, when he directed illegal hush money payments to two women during the 2016 campaign to buy their silence about alleged affairs. That is what the documents say. Joining me now is Republican Congressman Jim Renacci. He serves on the House Ways and Means Committee. Congressman, thanks so much for being with us. I want to read you some of a Washington Post op-ed from 44 former senators. It says, it is our shared view that we are entering a dangerous period. At other critical moments in our history, when constitutional crises have threatened our foundations, it has been the Senate that has stood in defense of our democracy. Today is once again such a time. We urge current and future senators to be steadfast and zealous guardians of our democracy by ensuring that partisanship or self-interest not replace national interest. Now, leave aside the Senate elitism there. You are about to be a former member of Congress. These former members of Congress are basically saying, put partisanship aside as you assess what you are seeing from the Mueller investigation. Is that good advice?
Well, first off, I say we should put partisanship aside on all decisions we make. I mean, that's one of the biggest problems I've had here in 8 years is that partisanship gets involved in too many of our decision making. And in the end, we should take the partisanship out and do what's right for the American people. So I'm always in agreement that let's get a partisanship out of some of our decisions. Let's make sure we protect our Constitution and our democracy.
What is your advice to members of the House, both Republicans and Democrats, specifically in dealing with these revelations that are now coming to light? 16 people close to the president who had contact with the Russians during the campaign. This document from the Southern District of New York, which says that the president directed and coordinated with Michael Cohen to break the law. How would you advise members in the House to handle this?
Well, I've said all along we need to let the investigation just come to a conclusion, although I do believe after 2 years the conclusion should be near. I also believe that let's see what all comes out. Let's see what all plays out, and let's not make any decisions in advance. Too many people want to make decisions early. The partisanship gets involved way too early. Let's let everything ride out. Let's get Mueller to finish up his case. He's been looking at this for 2 years. Clearly, there's no collusion, but let's see what the facts have, and let's move on.
Can I just say, we don't know if there's no clearly yet. Clearly, they have not laid out exact examples and documentation of what you might call collusion. However, there are those 16 points of contacts. There is this 2015 meeting for a Russian seeking political synergy, which someone might call collusion. There's the Trump Tower meeting where Don Jr. was promised dirt on Hillary Clinton, to which he responded, if that's what it is, I love it. So it depends how you define collusion. What we have not had yet, as you say, is Robert Mueller tell us he's found collusion.
Well, and absolutely. But I think if Robert Mueller had already found collusion, this investigation would have wrapped up very quickly. I do think that right now we're looking at all kind of pieces outside of the specific job that he was really hired to come on board for, which was to see if there was collusion, see if there was an issue. And let's face it, the American people want to be able to move past this as well. So, again, I think it's time to wrap this up. I've said this for the last year. He's had 2 years. I was a business guy for 28 years before I came here. By now, you'd be telling your attorneys, let's wrap this up and see where we're at, because it is costing the American people money.
It is. I just want to, again, on the notion that everything he's found is outside the issue of Russia. He did indict 12 Russians for hacking the DNC and then leaking it to WikiLeaks to release to the American public. He did have Michael Cohen plead guilty to lying to Congress about what he said about dealings with Russia well into the campaign and the fact that he was telling the president about it. So it's not as if there's nothing having to do with Russia here, correct?
Well, again, what I've said is he is now looking at all this. He's had 2 years. Let's bring it to a conclusion. And I think that's what I would advise anybody, whether you're a Republican or Democrat. Bring it to a conclusion. Get this moving on. The American people want to see our country moving forward. Mm-hmm. And as I traveled the state of Ohio for the last 9 months, they're very frustrated. They want to see our country move forward. They like, in many ways, what this president's doing. But they also see a problem that too often politics are getting in the way. Mm-hmm. Democrats want to talk about impeachment. Republicans want to talk about border wall issues. Again, let's just move this forward. That's the frustration I see when I'm out in, you know, in real America, as I call it, outside the Beltway.
So the president needs a new chief of staff. What do you think about that job in the abstract? What would be your reservations about taking that job?
Well, look, I think it's an honor always to be the chief of staff for the president. I think but the chief of staff is a tough job. You are constantly, either blocking or tackling. You're the guy or gal in between. It's a very tough job, but this president will find somebody. There are a lot of people like myself that like the direction that he's moving the country forward on, and I think those will be the people that step up and step into that position.
Mark Meadows of the Freedom Caucus is said to be one of the people that the president has his eye on, and he hasn't ruled out that possibility. Is he the type of person that you think can bring the White House together and help bring the country together?
The person I think that needs to be in that position is somebody who can work with both sides of the aisle. I do believe that's important. I mean, one of the things that I've said for the last 8 years in Washington is I have a bipartisan breakfast that I'm going to right after this interview. And what we try and do is work together. So I think whoever is in that position has to be able to realize when he comes over to Capitol Hill or where people come to the White House, he or she has to be nonpartisan and try and bring people together, because that's the only way we're going to move our country forward.
I got to say, and you can love what the Freedom Caucus does, but it doesn't seem that their mission statement is necessarily to work together in bipartisanship. Are you suggesting that Mark Meadows, who has driven the Freedom Caucus for the last few years, might not be the right person to bring folks together?
Well, again, that'll be the president's decision, not mine.
But what's your view of it, though?
Well, look, I like Mark. He's a good individual. He has his principles that he holds pretty strong to, which I understand. But in the end, the president's going to have to pick somebody who I really believe understands that there are Republicans and Democrats out there. And he needs somebody, in my opinion, again, only my opinion, that can work with both sides.
Okay. Is that Mark Meadows?
Well, you know, again, I know Mark very well. He's a good guy. I don't know how much he does work across the aisle, but I do know there are a lot of individuals that can, and Mark probably could as well.
Where is the deal to be made on the budget? We have, I think, until December 22nd to get this funding without a partial government shutdown. Democrats offering $1.3 billion for border security, which would include fencing. Where is there a way to make a deal between that and the $5 billion the president wants for the wall?
Well, right now we're in political decisions again, which is always so frustrating. I mean, the difference between 1.3 and 5 is so small when you think we spend $4 trillion a year. So again, I think this has become a political issue. Nancy Pelosi has to worry about getting the 218. She's got to try and make sure that her left flank is with her, so she's got to be a little bit cautious. I got to tell you, if it wasn't for that, this deal would be done already. We'd be home. I mean, that's the other problem I've always had. We move too quickly just to get to Christmas break instead of moving in a pace to get things accomplished. But this deal would have been done already if it wasn't for Nancy Pelosi needing the 218, because we're talking about a small amount.
Well, but didn't the president have a chance to make this deal also, and the president couldn't bring his folks to it? It was Republicans who voted by and large against, or many Republicans voted against the various deals that were put on the floor as well.
Well, look, that's why I said politics gets in the way of a lot of things. I do believe that we have to make decisions moving our country forward. Sometimes that means you only get 80% of you want, not 80% of what you want, not 100% of what you want. And I do blame both Republicans and Democrats when it comes to that. And that's in the end, we have to be able to move things forward. But that's why the difference between 1.5 is so small that let's move this forward. Let's get this issue off the table and let's start working toward the best interests of the American people.
We'll let you go to that bipartisan breakfast that you're headed to. I hope it is well attended, frankly. Jim Renacci of Ohio, thanks so much for being with us.
Thank you.
Okay, John, how much prison time will Michael Cohen get this week for a crime that he says the president directed him to commit? One former prosecutor has experience, but the judge who will be deciding that, he's here next.
Hey, a quick question.
Is CNN legal analyst Ellie Honing, a former federal prosecutor who has argued in front of the very judge that Michael Cohen faces. Ellie, great to have you here with your particular perspective. So this is Judge William Pauley. You've been in his courtroom many times. What's he like?
He's tough. He's fair but tough. He's a little intimidating. Just to give you a visual, if you've seen My Cousin Vinny, the judge in that movie, he actually looks fairly like Judge Pauley, and he's intimidating. But he's fair. And one of the things that Judge Pauley is big on is he has very little tolerance for people who are in positions of authority or power who abuse those positions. And you can see the Southern District knows that because in their sentencing memo for Cohen, they stress he was a person of means, he was a person of education who committed these crimes out of greed.
So does that tell you that he is not going to look favorably on Michael Cohen and may sentence him, maybe may throw the book at him?
It does. It does. I would not be feeling good if I was Michael Cohen or his legal team right now. His sentencing guidelines range, which is kind of the starting point for a sentence, it's not binding, but the judge has to consider it, is 51 to 63 months, a little over four, a little over 5 years.
That's a lot.
It's a lot of time. It is. The federal sentencing guidelines are tough. And he was engaged in high number fraud, tax fraud, income fraud, bank fraud, in
Those
addition
are separate,
to the campaign finance.
Separate and apart from the campaign finance, from his taxi business.
Right, exactly. And what happens under the federal guidelines, it all gets mashed together and you come out with a number. And he comes out to 51 to 63 months. I do think he'll get something below that, but not much.
Why do you think it will be below those sentencing guidelines if Judge Pauley is kind of a tough judge?
Because both the Southern District and Mueller, to varying extents, asked for Cohen to get some downward consideration, not complete, but some downward consideration for his cooperation. The Southern District sort of begrudgingly says he gave us a little bit of information, but he didn't want to answer certain questions. So because he was helpful to Mueller, he should get something. Mueller's a little more enthusiastic. Mueller says, look, he was credible. He was consistent with the other evidence. He should get some consideration.
Here's a relevant passage from the SDNY sentencing memo. With respect to both payments, this is about the campaign finance laws, the hush money payments to the porn star and the Playboy playmate. With respect to both payments, Cohen acted with the intent to influence the 2016 presidential election in particular. And as Cohen himself has now admitted, with respect to both payments, he acted in coordination with and at the direction of Individual One. And we know Individual One is Donald Trump. And Michael Cohen has reportedly been telling friends and I think some reporters that he is mystified as to why he would face 5 years in prison. I mean, if you count the campaign finance laws in with the mashed up other things, for committing a crime at the behest of Donald Trump, and Donald Trump is unscathed. How does that work?
Yeah, so look, part of the campaign finance is only part of what's driving that 5 years, but Donald Trump's the president. There are different policies that DOJ has regarding the president. But that passage that you just read, Allison, is so important because there you have the United States Department of Justice, I think for the first time in this administration, committing on paper in something submitted to a judge, which Southern District would not do unless they had it locked in, that the president was involved in the campaign finance violations.
So you see that as above and beyond Michael Cohen. That, to you, is the most relevant thing that has happened in the past week that is a game changer.
Absolutely. I mean, there is no way the Southern District would put that in writing just because a cooperating witness, one who they weren't super enthusiastic about.
Michael it's not Cohen, just based on Michael Cohen's word.
They have to have more. They have to have something more than Michael Cohen's word.
Such as?
Could be documents showing, could be another witness who they deem reliable, could be emails, could be tapes, could be anything. But like Robert Mueller, Robert Mueller's batting 1,000. Everything that Robert Mueller has committed to in court papers has proven out. Southern District has the same standard. I work there. I know that they're extremely careful, especially in a case of this high priority.
I mean, that's a totally separate and a part than Michael Cohen's sentencing, but that's the part that you think that when it is finally revealed, that's when America, and Democrats will have to figure out how they want to treat Donald Trump.
Yeah, I think the campaign finance violations are the most readily provable offenses right now. I think if you had to, you could probably go into a grand jury, put aside that it's the president, and probably come back with an indictment based on the existing evidence. Politically, I think there's a separate question. Is that going to be enough to move Republicans off of him? And I think the larger corruption piece, which again, Cohen's relevant to the Moscow project, the $100 million development deals they were trying to do, that I think may be enough to move Republicans on the political end.
Well, we shall see about that. But last, I mean, given that you know Judge Pauley, I read that you said that you even have received tongue lashings
it's true.
From him. How do you think that this whole moment is going to go this week when Michael Cohen is sentenced?
I think Judge Pauley is going to come down hard on him. I think Judge Pauley is going to have very little sort of sympathy for Michael Cohen, and I do think he's going to be sentenced to multiple years in prison.
And exactly how many months would you say?
If you put me to it, if I had to guess here on the spot, I'm going to put the over-under at 36 months.
We'll see. That's a long time in prison.
It is.
Ellie Honig, thank you.
Thanks,
very
Allison.
Much. Thanks for all the perspective. John.
All right. Great discussion, Allison. Thanks so much. So imagine this for a Democratic presidential race in 2020. Bernie versus Beto. It's a lot of bees. We'll discuss next. That was your favorite
your
subject.
Tongue.
Look, there's a lot of interesting developments. There are a lot of interesting developments in the Democratic field for president in 2020. Let's discuss, because we are running out of time. Joining us now is Harry Etten, obviously our senior political analyst. There is something about Harry. Harry, lay out just how close we are.
Well, I just want to point out, I know Allison doesn't believe necessarily in this 2020 stuff, but I believe so firmly in it that I got myself a new sport coat,
wow,
a new shirt. We got new shoes.
This is all in honor of 2020.
All in honor of 2020, because look, we're only 99 weeks away.
What do the numbers tell us?
Right. So first off, this is a very interesting thing. Remember, it was really young voters that seemed to really go into Bernie Sanders' camp, 18 to 39-year-olds. They made up 32% of the electorate. They went for Bernie Sanders by 27 percentage points. Now, the question is, why were they so attracted to it? Well, clearly, it wasn't this liberal thing, because we see this, and there's
it's
not... Right, exactly. But I would argue that the reason that they really liked Bernie Sanders was because they saw him as an independent. Remember, Bernie Sanders basically has two things going for him, right? He's very progressive, but he also isn't actually a registered Democrat. He's an independent with the Democratic caucus.
This isn't an independent big eye thing, though.
Right.
This is not tied to the party, which is a bigger issue, or an outsider would be a different way of saying it.
Right. He is seen as an outsider, and that is what a lot of young people consider themselves at. In fact, if you would go through the Pew Research Center and you were to look and say, okay, say you call yourself a Democrat, would you say you're actually a Democrat, or are you an independent leaning in the Democratic column? Millennials are much more likely to say they're leaning in the Democratic column, but they actually first consider themselves an independent. And this is exactly what the numbers show. The independents made up 24% of Democratic primary voters, and they went for Bernie Sanders by a 29-point margin, which, you know, looks an awful, whoops, wrong slide, awful bit like this number with this 27, and then you go here, and you get this 29.
But do they consider Beto an outsider?
Well, let's think about this, right? Beto O'Rourke is this young guy, kind of perhaps, you know, align himself with young voters. And he's only a three-term congressman, or was a three-term congressman, will be out of a job come January, from the state of Texas. And he was able to sell himself as this sort of outsider candidate. And this is the type of candidate I think Bernie Sanders could have a lot of problems with. I think, forget Beto O'Rourke for a second, I think there are going to be a lot of candidates who are going to be running who don't necessarily have that Washington stink with them and may be able to go into Bernie Sanders' backyard and take a lot of these independent
votes. That, in the end, maybe what the most important part of this is, as you're looking at it, it's not a Bernie and Beto thing. There's this notion that everyone is running to the left in this Democratic primary, or there's a rush to the left. But these numbers suggest it may not be the left that's the place to go. It's the outside that's the place to go.
Exactly right. Because remember, we go back to this liberal side. It was a tie. Hillary Clinton was seen as liberal enough by most people who are voting in that Democratic primary. It was just that she wasn't able to sell herself necessarily as this independent outside of the party establishment. So if we were to look at the lanes going into 2020, it may not be that this sort of Bernie Sanders lane is filled by a progressive. It could, in fact, be filled by someone who actually has a much more moderate voting record. Remember, Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton in 2008. Yeah, Barack Obama didn't vote for the war in Iraq, but he was able to win over these independent young voters. And remember, this huge gap among young voters. So someone who's able to sell themselves as someone who's from outside the party establishment and maybe young and hip. Remember, we were talking last week, John, you were in here. We missed you so much.
Thank you.
Where you looked at what the people, the Iowa chairman, Democratic chairman, were thinking about. They saw and said, we want someone who's young, and that meets Beto O'Rourke pretty well, and it meets a lot of the candidates, too.
Did they say former punk rocker?
I don't know very much about music except for my uncles and television theme songs. How about the Roy Rogers jingle from 1986? We were talking about Roy Rogers beforehand.
I knew
big
he was
fan.
Going to work in a reference to Nesedaka.
Right. But you did punk rock, so it's the same thing.
Did you know the Roy Rogers one, though?
No, I don't.
Well,
we hum a few bars in the commercial.
There we
right?
go.
We want viewers. Harris Forecast is available each day by 9 a.m. at CNN.com/forecast. It will include the range and certainty of the prediction, good one, along with a daily column to break down what it means for Democrats, Republicans, and you.
Nothing sells like the range of the prediction. Vladimir Putin's Russia suspected of trying to influence voters. It's not the story you think you know. A CNN reality check next.
When we were dating, we used to get
it shows a group of New York City police officers ripping a child from his mother. At one point, one officer pulls out a yellow stun gun and begins to point it around the room. The chaotic scene unfolded at a government welfare office in Brooklyn. The NYPD says officers were there on a disorderly conduct call. Officers say they tried to get the woman to move numerous times, but she refused. She was arrested on several charges, including resisting arrest. The NYPD calls the incident, quote, disturbing, and says it is under review.
Right, five missing Marines missing a in a mid-air collision off the coast of Japan have been declared dead. The victims were among seven crew members aboard two military aircraft that crashed. The U.S. military called off a search for the Marines on Tuesday. The identities of the Marines have not been released. U.S., Japanese, and Australian forces conducted more than 800 hours of air and maritime search operations covering more than 35,000 square miles of ocean.
Well, Russia's President Vladimir Putin directed thousands of fake Twitter accounts to help influence a vote. Does that sound familiar? Well, it's not our election that we're talking about.
There's a twist.
Yes, there's a twist. It's Brexit. And in many ways, the effects have been far worse. CNN senior political analyst John Avalon has our reality check. Tell us about this one, John.
That's right, Ali. So today, British politics is polarized and paralyzed thanks to Brexit. That's the narrow nationalist vote to leave the EU that was seen as a populist predecessor to President Trump. Trump even promised his own election would be, quote, Brexit plus, plus, plus. But the devil's in the details, and the process is totally shambolic, with Prime Minister Theresa May today punting a key Brexit vote in Parliament to January. Look, we are a long way from the heady days of the nationalist movement captured in this Economist cover from November 2016. There's victorious Donald Trump marching alongside Mr. Brexit, Nigel Farage, and Vladimir Putin. In the background, there's Francis Marine Le Pen. Now, lest you think the Putin reverence is kind of a cheap shot, we know that Moscow Bank funded Le Pen's political party, and Parliament is currently investigating whether Russia backed Brexit financially or via social media. For example, on the day of the Brexit referendum, the Twitter troll machine went into overdrive with an estimated 150,000 Russia-linked accounts tweeting over and over again in support of Brexit. Some prominent pro-Trump accounts, like Jenna Abrams, promoted the Brexit cause before being exposed as a Russian troll. Now, it's funny how some of these alleged nationalist voices for strengthening sovereignty end up pushing Putin's foreign policy. Weird. But that's not all. The former head of the UK Independence Party, Nigel Farage, shares a strange reluctance to criticize Vladimir Putin, but is quick to criticize European sanctions against Russia. Farage was in contact with WikiLeaks' Julian Assange, who released the Russian-hacked DNC documents. And we also know about multiple previously undisclosed meetings between the backers of Brexit and the Russian ambassador to the UK. Not only that, the Brexit bros reached out to Steve Bannon's data firm, Cambridge Analytica, to work up a plan for raising money and pro-Brexit sentiment in the USA. Now, all of this has gotten the attention of Bob Mueller, who's taken a particularly keen interest in Trump campaign advisor and Brexit booster Ted Malik. So, just to recap, we've got two nations with budding nationalist movements, two bold but easily influenced leaders who like strongmen, thousands of fake Twitter accounts, and one man behind it, Vladimir Putin. Top House Intel Democrat Adam Schiff neatly summed it all up, quote, the peril.